Hi, I'm Father Justin Ramos, and we're uniting heaven and earth. Our story begins in 1961, when our seven Hungarian fathers left communist Hungary and founded St. Michael's Abbey here in Orange County, California. Thanks to your prayers and support, St. Michael's now numbers almost 100 confers, 50 priests, and close to 40 seminarians. We're going to talk about the monumental art in the Abbey Church, what it means, why it's important, how to read it. Enzo, what is sacred art and why is it important?
That's a great question, Father. When we talk about sacred art, we're talking about a concept which is really ancient, older than history. And what I mean by that is that every religion for which we have a record, and frankly even the ones we don't have a record for, seem to have registered this gap between the divine and the profane, between the realm of the gods and our own. And so out of this deep longing, we have this concept that's born, which is art and architecture, which is really focused on bridging that gap. And we call that sacred art. Sacred art has, in general, two motions. One is to take what is in heaven and bring it down to earth, and then make what is on earth a map of heaven.
Enzo, could you speak into that a little bit more so we can understand?
Like an example?
Yes.
So, for example, you have the Angkor Wat or some of the great Egyptian temples. You have an alignment to the solstice or an alignment to a particular constellation. The whole plan of the temple is based on this alignment to the stars. And so as the temple extends itself into the plan, it continues to replicate what is in heaven. So the temple becomes, in a physical sense, a map of what is in the heavens. But it's also connected because what's actually happening with the sun or the moon or the stars is interacting with that building. It really isn't that different from the concept within Christianity of how we have traditionally taken those same steps to physically symbolize a unity between heaven and earth, and then also to bring in the actual divine mysteries to the contemplation of the worshiper or the visitor, and bring the mystical or spiritual realities of the heavens and make them visible and understandable in that sense.
That's fascinating, but how does that apply to a Christian building, a Christian church?
Right. Well, it's really, really important to note that we have a special Christian understanding of this. The pagan temple, per se, was never a place for assembly. In the Roman era, for example, the idol of the god was situated in the temple, but it wasn't for people to come into the temple. Their offerings were made outside. The difference between the pagan temple and the Jewish temple, and therefore our Christian church, is that our tradition builds sacred space where God brings together and meets his people, where he dwells among them. Again, our church building calls and gathers and assembles the Christian faithful to communion with their God. The building is the stones, and as St. Paul says, the people are the living stones. And of course, the high point of this meeting is in the sacrifice of the altar, which is the real presence. And we meet him as he met his people from the Holy of Holies in the Jerusalem temple. So it's a very important distinction to make between the ancient pagan structures and our Christian churches, because even though they have obvious similarities physically, they are not the same. Incidentally, this is why the Latin Church in her history chose the Roman basilica form and not the Roman temple form as its model. The basilica, of course, being a place of public meeting. Another way that we build as Christians is through the cruciform church, which means a church built in the shape of a cross. So it's these multiple layers of meaning and symbolism that aid us, because we, after all, are flesh and blood, in understanding the spiritual reality through the physical world that represents the divine to us. So at St. Michael's, we do have something of a cruciform quality with the altar and the sanctuary and the two large apses on either side. But the building itself is not cruciform.
So, my question to you, Father, is why did the fathers choose a non-cruciform church, which is also very ancient, as opposed, let's say, to another shape?
And so that's a good question. The fathers actually chose to build in the basilica style, which is basically a rectangle. When you first enter, that's called the narthex, and then the nave. And as you go down the nave, you get to the east side, if you were on the west side entering in. And when you get to the east side, there's usually a platform there, and it's circular. That's called the apse. There is where the representative of the emperor in the Roman days used to preside with his court. So this is an ancient Roman building, and Christians adopted it for liturgical worship. And why is that important? Because now Christ presides on that eastern apse with his court, the bishop, his priests, and the entire body, which is the church.
And the east is important because it's also a symbol of the resurrection.
Exactly. We all know that the sun rises from the east, and Christ will come on the last day from the east. So we all face in that direction, ad orientem, that is to the orient, to the east, where Christ will come on the last day. The Abbey church that we are building is beautiful for many, many reasons, but especially because as you enter in, not only will you see this magnificent structure, that 70-foot vault, but that also helps with elevating the soul to God, uniting us to heaven. And part of that means it will help the Gregorian chant. It will also have many focal points for other pieces of art, which we'll talk about later in the series.
Father, the ancient temples and an innumerable amount of our own churches have something astronomical going on. What about St. Michael's?
Yes, St. Michael's, very unique. When the sun is going to be setting on the 29th of September, which is the feast of St. Michael, that sun ray would come through the western window, which is the rose window, and it would come down, the sunlight would come down through the nave into the choir and to the altar. And it's, as you said before, it would help us, it would remind us that we are uniting to heaven. And it's on St. Michael's Day, we're St. Michael's Abbey. On that specific day, we want to see that union present.
Father, I can't help but notice we have a lot more to talk about.
We sure do. When we get together again, I want us to talk about all the art that's going into the church, particularly on the east apse, the triumphal arch. Maybe you can give us a little preview of that.
Absolutely, Father. You're going to see the piers and arches soaring to that 70-foot vault you mentioned. There will be a floor-to-ceiling mosaic to that height, depicting the Last Judgment, the coronation of Our Lady, and her assumption into heaven. You'll see the dead coming back to life in the resurrection, the angels sounding the trumpet, the battle with the dragon. It's really a plethora of symbolism and imagery to the glory of God.
And the colors will be radiant and shimmering because it's a mosaic.
Every little piece made by hand.
That's right. We'll go over the stained glass windows, which are magnificent. They're bright, and they really reflect or are an extension of the mosaic, the shimmering colors, a plethora of colors coming from the mosaic. We'll also look at the murals in the shrines, on the six shrines in the nave. And we'll also see the polychrome, which will be in all of the chapels down here in the crypt.
Those are the statues here, right here behind us.
That's right. That polychrome are the statues of the different saints that will be in the small chapel shrines here.
And what about if we go up? What are we going to see?
Ah, yes. In the bell tower. That's what you're referring to, right?
That's right.
The magnificent bells there, which were cast in France and which have beautiful names. We'll talk about those as well.
Tremendous.
We can't wait to show you more. More to glorify God and comfort the faithful who will come here to seek Him in spirit and in truth. Join us next time as we continue building to unite heaven and earth.